And so a lot of training in behavior analysis is more in like NAT or DTT.
Rewind the clock to 2010, the behavior analyst, one of our journals, Hynek, Carr, LeBlanc, and Severinsen, published an article that was titled On the Use of Fluency Training in the Behavioral Treatment of Autism, a Commentary. The general taste that they leave in your mouth is that there's too many unanswered questions, and we should really be diving into this more. I'm gonna let you form your own opinion, but today we're going to talk about fluency-based instruction and how it... I forgot to mention, this is brought to you by Operant Coffee! Go check them out! And how it actually quite nicely meshes with what we do on a day-to-day in autism treatment services.
All right, sitting down with Kerri Milyko. You may have seen her online in the forums. You're always commenting in there.
Yeah.
Past president of the Standard Acceleration Society.
Yeah.
You own and have opened, what, two companies now?
Formally?
One in Florida and then one here in Reno.
Yeah, so two center. Yeah, two different companies at our centers.
Yeah, yeah. Wealth of precision teaching knowledge.
Yeah. And I have recently been elected on the board of Standard Acceleration Society now.
Okay.
So yeah, and I am adjunct faculty at the University of West Florida that has a strong focus on precision teaching for their master's classes.
Very cool.
Yeah.
All right.
So I don't think that I've ever run into a behavior analyst who doesn't appreciate fluency. I think it's either it's not my bag or they just don't know how to program for it. And so a lot of training in behavior analysis is more in like NAT or DTT.
So discrete trial training is DTT, and that is a very structured way to implement in a way to where you can teach someone how to engage in some sort of behavior. Now, the other side of that is kind of like on the other end of the spectrum is natural environment training, NET. And it's similar in the sense of the goals of teaching something, but it's in a way that looks a little more natural or playful. Yeah, we're gonna go with that. So the point of the article is we do not have as much data. It's not as robust of an area of research. So we should be really careful how we implement that. And although that's true, there's a whole different side to this, and that is the private practice, the results that are being seen that aren't being shared in our empirical journals. An issue, yes, but there's a more complete picture that you can form here.
Like, we all get a lot of practice opportunities in like discrete trial teaching,
yep.
Right? So
yep.
How does this blend with that? Like,
well, and I'm not saying kick discrete trials out the door because there's a time and place for them. What I'm saying is that if that time and place is necessary, you include that into like an actual timing. And the timing doesn't just mean 15 seconds, let's go as fast as you can. It's saying, let's look at this timing period.
Yeah.
So we have some learners that aren't ready to sit down and run through targets in a quick time period because their attention is all over the place, or they're still learning how to sit, or we're chasing after them with our clicker, right? So we can give like a time block. If it's 20 minutes, if it's the entire session, you need to shorten it back to eventually where it's like 5 minutes or 1 minute. And then now, once they become a little, they have some of those learning to learn behaviors and a little better student, if you will, then we can shift it to make it a little bit easier on the instructor, the teacher, the therapist, to be like, okay, so now we have X amount of targets that we want to get through. Let's see how quickly you can do that. And what you want to see is that time period shortening. And I do this because these are my record floors going up the chart. And you want to see that time period shortening so that way they're more fluent on that skill. And then when you see that across multiple skills, then you can be like, let's try some fixed timings. Let's try doing this in a minute. Or sometimes a minute's a lifetime for some kids. So we want to shorten it to like 15 seconds. I don't know if you've ever sat down and done vowel sounds for a minute, but it makes you want to stab yourself in the eye, right? So there's some skills that are better equipped for shorter periods of time versus longer. So it's a shaping process.
Yeah, I was gonna say you're describing a shaping process.
Exactly. Yeah. And the thing is that, to say that discrete trials is garbage would be a lie. It's produced changes in so many people's behavior, but that's not the end point. And if we don't include that analysis with respect to time, then again, as I mentioned before, we're losing out a huge variable. So we want to look at that, and we can look at how do we shape this learner to be than ready to go and sit in the classroom and learn from a teacher, or ready to play on a sports team with other friends, or be able to have these components that are able to then form to a more complex composite, right? So we need those data, and we can do that when we include those trials in the context of a timing, and that timing can be any length of time.
So finding a company that would actually offer this sort of training and was knowledgeable in these different areas was tricky oftentimes. You have to move somewhere where, you know, they had these funky blue paper charts and they were super, super into them. So much so that they, wore weird t-shirts like this, you know? But the cool thing is those things are changing. With technology, we have other options. So Chartlytics is one. We've seen Amy, she's currently working with Chartlytics. That is one option. Now the other that I'm actually super stoked to share with you is a mentorship model online class that Kerri has developed. So let's listen in on that.
That's awesome. So you're focusing on how do you help like bring the mentorship component into this, right? That's
So, I've had multiple meetings with some great big name precision teachers that I love and admire. Like one of them is Chuck Morbitz, and we constantly talk about this mentorship model, and it's so needed in precision teaching. And then, you know, hopefully, you know, you always want to get to like mass distribution. How do you, you know, make it so that more people get it, which is one purpose of this course.
Yeah.
But I think because so much of our training in to become a BCBA or to become an RBT is focused on discrete trials, changing that worldview, that mindset, just kind of shifting the lens on your glasses to look at things as a free operant requires multiple exemplar training.
Yeah.
And it requires some like, you know, probing questions and digging deep and trying it with a learner and brainstorming, because right now precision teaching is, I think there's tons of us who are trying to create resources for dissemination. Mm-hmm. It still isn't out there in the way that it's out there for the rest of behavior analysis. So right now, the mentorship, the apprentice model, I mean, if you can engulf yourself and work at a learning lab or work at a school that does precision teaching like Morningside or Hovland, then you'll get it and you'll drink the Kool-Aid, I'm sure, within like a day, you know? But if you're picking this up on your own solo and you don't have that community to bounce off on, it's really hard.
Yeah.
And then you look and you're reading, you're like, oh, am I only supposed to do 1 minute timings? I'm not allowed to do discrete trials, you know, like all of these things that you can kind of fall subject to.
Mm-hmm.
And I think precision teaching has evolved from that.
So not only has it evolved greatly since then, there's been an explosion in just precision teaching centers across the US, but there's also things that were missed from that original analysis. So this right here is a summary of over 30,000 projects that were submitted and analyzed. I'm gonna link the article down below. It's super interesting by a gentleman named Carl Koenig. All right, to finish up, Kerri's gonna describe what she's built here, and then I'll be back.
It is a 6 week class,
yeah.
2 hours on a Friday morning. And I section it off with, they have to kind of come in with some base knowledge of precision teaching, whether they take our online classes or done Chartlytics or they've taken a, you know, course or they spent a semester somewhere getting some experience. So we're not gonna go over how to chart.
Yeah.
We're not gonna go over like, I'm not going to convince you that frequency is
something
a fundamental, versus percent correct. Yeah. So you have to come in with a little bit of that, but we're going to go over, and they also come in with a case. So it's a case study because we want to apply this.
Yeah.
So whether it's their significant other, teaching them how to learn another language, or speeding up their swim strokes, or increasing the amount of water that they drink, or it's an actual client, or it's something, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. Find a person, even if it's yourself, I would like for it to be another person, but because, you know, contingencies.
Yep.
And so that way we can create actual curriculum. We plot actual data, we make specific interventions, but they start off though with pinpointing, how to actually pinpoint the behavior. And that's where we bring in like this really huge focus on free operant. And then scaling.
So, okay, this is your pinpoint, but does your learner have these components for this to actually be the target that you should be working on?
Yeah.
Assessing their behavior and again, identifying, is this the, you know, okay, so what level at which should you intervene with this being your goal?
Yeah.
And then we look at curriculum design, and that's not just like a worksheet, although sometimes it is, mm-hmm. but it's like, okay, so how do we customize this intervention to promote free operant, to promote increased practice opportunities, stuff like that. What is your error correction protocol going to be? How is that specific for this learner? How to determine aims? Because if we're coming in with a whole bunch of different cases, sometimes we're going to be working on behaviors that the aims aren't published somewhere, right? So how do we figure out what that fluency aim is going to be, right? And then we do case presentations. Everyone presents their curriculum. We have this... everyone gets to share the curriculum that everyone generates, which is kind of an open source content. I put in my stuff too,
cool.
So that way they can have samples to pull from, templates to use. And I'm share that with your audience.
Yes, I was gonna say, we've got a few things we're gonna be able to share to everyone. I will know by then who it is. We're gonna announce really quick who is from the Patreon group that's gonna jump into this.
Great.
Congratulations, Shanda.
Thank you for offering that up.
I'm so excited.
That's
awesome. This is going to be great. I mean, someone who's passionate about learning this and is going to get something out of it and then spread it to the masses, that's what we're looking for.
That's the goal.
Yeah.
All right, you know the drill. The link's down below. I hope that you enjoyed this. Like, share, subscribe. It actually makes a difference. Remember, it's Precision Teaching Week. It's like Shark Week, but it's better. All right, that's it. I'll see you later. That's your Daily BA.